Welcome back to Dan on Dev. I've wrapped up now the Why All Application Security Products Suck series as I went through all the different application security products in the kind of the major categories. So I went through the SAST, DAST, IAST, SCA, WAF, RASP. I went to the pen testing, and also I ended up doing one on the bug bounty. So I kind of wrapped up the products and services there, and now I'm talking to experts. And this time, I brought in somebody to discuss the defensive products, the web application firewall and the real-time application self-protection, or RASP, products. So the WAF and RASP, I brought in somebody that could really speak to that, somebody that actually founded a company called tCell that I ended up working with at Rapid7. Really amazing guy. I love his leadership style. And the way he really focuses on the team is just a fantastic guy. So I really wanted to bring him in and bring in his expertise because he's actually been there building a product, talking to customers, figuring out what they need. And so we're gonna jump to that here in a moment. Before I do, if this series has been useful to you, please click the like, subscribe, send a comment, give me your thoughts. I would like to have a conversation with you as well as the experts that I'm bringing in. So we can continue diving in to figure out how do the products that exist today get better and where is the disruption going to come from? I'm really curious about that part of things. And without further ado, we'll be talking to Boris Chen on the other side of the jump. All right, now we are joined by a former colleague of mine. Boris Chen worked on the RASP product that Rapid7 had acquired. So Boris, I'll go ahead and let you introduce yourself a little bit.
So I've been in the tech industry in general for, you know, a bit over 30 years. Before I left, I was running AppSec portfolio products rolled up under my organization, led those initiatives. Before coming into Rapid7, as you mentioned, co-founder of a company called tCell. tCell was a next generation WAF / RASP company that Rapid7 acquired in 2018. Before that, I'd been in different roles at different companies, including Splunk, BA Systems, WebLogic, Sybase. It goes way back. So I've been around.
So you've been in AppSec for a while, and you had the, you know, one of the few people who can say they've actually like started a next gen WAF RASP product. So you kind of really understand what goes into it and all the work and what is possible and what's very difficult. So I thought it'd be great to have you on as we kind of really discuss the defensive products and you had a chance to go through the RASP episode, right? So I guess I'll just ask you, I didn't get a chance to ask you before, but so what did you think? What, like, my perspective on it is, could be very different than yours, but what do you think? Where did I go wrong? Maybe, you know, maybe it's just starting off how I described it. Was that a fairly reasonable description?
Yeah, well, I like the visual. It's definitely a cool analogy. You know, most analogies, you know, there's always analogies have power in description, but there's always limitations. And so in the attachment side of things, yes, it's runs, you know, it becomes part of the brain, essentially. Not necessarily say it control per se, but it definitely can insert itself in controlling certain things inside the application, specifically for defensive purposes. So our analogy at tCell was more of a was basically, well, the name tCell, as you can imagine, the immune system was our metaphor, and so we would be inside the application. We'd be able to identify malicious activity and be able to neutralize that with inside the application.
So the primary way, if I remember correctly, that you largely identified was looking at user behavior patterns and trying to identify like when somebody was a malicious actor or something to that effect, right?
Yeah. I mean, we basically had a multifaceted approach to identifying bad actors. Some of it was behavioral, like looking at, say, for instance, login activity is always a good signal if of something anomalous when someone's trying to break in, or they got in but went about it in a weird way. And then the other things are just other types of patterns of attack. You know, things that the application normally wouldn't do, and now it's doing from this one source. Those things become a bit, become notable, and we note that, and we analyze that all on the back end to surface up to the user what things that they should look into that basically indicate, something might be amiss.
So in order to do that, you it's necessary to create a bunch of specific support for different languages and frameworks so that you could really get good intel, right, on how the application is weathering the activity, right, and kind of how it's responding.
Right.
What did you think of the kind of the breadth versus depth conversation, that I was proposing, and the challenge, I should say, that I was proposing? Is that, what do you think? Is that accurate? Is that off the mark?
No, that's fairly accurate. Yeah, that's accurate. I mean, I think that the coverage across different languages, have some commonality, but they also have their own uniqueness, unique threats that only occur for them. So, for instance, Java has log for shell, but you don't care about that in Ruby. There's probably some other kind of log exploit, but it's going to look significantly different because it's a different implementation and different behavior in logging and so on and so forth. So as far as like developing a product, you do have trade-off where, do we want to support as many language stacks and frameworks as possible? Do we want to do things that are more specialized for a given language or framework? Those are all things that go into deciding how to make the right balance for providing the most value for the customer and the product.
Yeah, I mean, there's always a trade-off, right? And that's kind of what I had talked about. Is like there's time and money, basically, right? And it's just where you can do that investment becomes the limiter.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely like companies that say, for instance, specialize only in Java. And they go very deep, and because that's all they do, and they specialize in it, and that's great. But other companies like us, we went for more breadth because basically the enterprises today don't typically settle on one stack anymore. There's usually just by how microservices work, there's more freedom to choose different stacks, but also there's acquisitions and so on and so forth. Things that sort of evolve into, like, it's, even though everyone would like one language in a company, it rarely happens.
Yeah, and I think that's, part of what I was, and I'm glad you said that, because I kind of maybe glossed over it a little bit in the original video, and I said, look, it a lot depends on your own environment and the way things are set up. If you're a smaller shop and you have everything in Java, yeah, then you would find the product that supports Java the best, right? And that's their focus. And you would go build that way, right? But if you're a larger enterprise, like you mentioned, you're going to have acquisitions, you're going to have all kinds of random crap, basically, and you got to be able to right. deal with that. So, but that's a good mm-hmm. a good bit of detail. Maybe I didn't, explain well enough. So thanks for bringing that up. Anything mm-hmm. And on the microservices, I mentioned that. And I don't know mm-hmm. that we talked about this previously, but the idea that, with all these different microservices, each thing is doing its own bit of work. So having to basically put an agent on every one of those pieces, that could be a challenge, right? That can be a problem, a difficulty for a RASP, as far as I've seen.
Yeah, yeah. And all of it's not necessarily technical, but it is organizational, because oftentimes the ownership is also distributed. And so different teams will have different stacks. They might have a different... They might even have different build systems. They have different infrastructure, and they sort when they deploy, there's stuff to tie everything together. But it's a challenge for a security team to roll it out. Oftentimes, doesn't have the ability to do it themselves because there's different types of ownerships. If a RASP requires a change to the build process, then that's maybe not even a developer, it's the infrastructure person who's assigned to. And then because you're going through different teams, sometimes you have a issue of a telephone, like, oh, this is the tool that does this, and this is what you do. And so it says, oh, okay, I got it, and then tells the other person. And by the time it gets to a person doing it, it's like, what? Why are we doing this again? And how does this work? And then you go read the docs, and then you say, I'll forget. I'll look at it later, and I'll work on this other thing. So it really does present a challenge as far as like rollout. Once everything's rolled out, everything's beautiful, especially if you have good automation scripts. You don't have any weird manual steps and that sort of thing. Once it's done, it's baked in and it just goes. But getting there can be a challenge depending on the organizational dynamics.
Yeah, that's a great point. And again, one of these things I kind of went over very quickly is the organizational challenge, the people process, trying to get all that coordinated. Technically having agents on each, making sure that each microservice is supported, but on top of that, the human process of just coordinating and going across the org can be difficult no matter what it is you're doing, but especially when you're really attaching something to the service and trying to understand how it has to run on each piece. Okay, so those are some of the negatives. Mm-hmm. As far as finalize the negatives on the web app firewalls, the WAF. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you had a chance to watch what I was saying about that, but basically I didn't have a lot of good to say. I don't know if you had a chance to see it, but I didn't have a ton of good. I was like, yeah, it's a PCI compliance. And what I'm talking about is the traditional WAF, right? There's ideas around improving that, and there's folks out there talking about kind of reinventing a next gen WAF, right? But talking about the traditional HTTP layer WAFs that are real signature based, basically the challenge there that I've seen is that it's too early in the process. The ability for it to parse the complex data structures that we see in applications today, all of the JSON traffic could be a massive mountain of JSON. They have to make a decision very quickly. So their ability to parse nested data structures, I think they're washed out because they have to then fail open, right? Very quickly. And a lot of times they just don't have time to parse it and analyze every little input on there. So that's part of the problem that I've seen and why like WAF evasion tends to be so readily functional, right, is getting around them. What's your thoughts on a traditional WAF?
They were developed in a different time, and that shows in how effective it is, because it doesn't, because the technology and stacks have evolved. Applications are no longer just, you go to a website, a web page, you click on a link, and it brings another website, right? Things are much more dynamic. And so you do have challenges of complex data being sent back. There's always evasion techniques. So no matter what you do in a WAF, there are bypasses. You can get better at it. You can definitely get better at the identifying when someone's trying to bypass. So even bypass identification is pretty a useful signal. Something's encoded that normally isn't encoded because, well, why is that? The app doesn't usually do that, so maybe that's a bad actor, right? So even if you don't know what they're encoding, what they're trying to do, sometimes you can pick up those kind of signals as well. But some of it requires a lot more sophistication and analytical ability. That's why we at tCell, we married the WAF approach with a cloud-based solution. Not only is it better for management when you have distributed systems, but also you can do a lot more analysis of attacks in a more sophisticated manner than just the one regex and either saying let it go or not let it go. So there are, I think WAFs definitely have their place. They do serve a purpose. Traditional WAFs have, depending on your infrastructure, if you have a traditional application, it's a legacy application, it might be fine for you. But yet, as us understand what the limitations are, you can't treat it as a silver bullet by any means. And then as your stack does evolve, if it's more modern, then you do have to look for more modern WAFs that have more awareness of what today's infrastructure typically looks like.
Yeah, that's a good point. If you're trying to protect a traditional application than a traditional WAF, you know, like the old school, you know, web app, then an old school web app firewall may actually serve a purpose. So that's a great point. Okay, so let's shift over to the positives. I think a defensive solution for application security is critical. We need defensive solutions. And to me, the RASP model, I think, is crucial. And maybe there's some other like new ways to rethink a WAF. In a lot of ways, the agent-based model offers so many opportunities and so much possibility that it seems to me like a pretty critical path, right, to keep moving and keep advancing. What do you think the future, what do you think the importance of the RASP agent-based technologies are in AppSec?
Yeah, I think that, like you say, in at the high level, I think you need to have some sort of active defensive mechanism. I think that that's, you know, at the end of the day is something, that is a piece of the puzzle that's vital. My analogy is always with performance. Like if you performance test your machine or your application, say, okay, it can handle X number of transactions per second, it can scale up to this many users, et cetera. That's all great. But that doesn't mean you're not going to have some monitoring to see, oh, when things slow down or when performance isn't great or you're not scaling properly. That kind of observability is critical, just as much as on the performance side. It's just as critical on the security side. You need to have that type of observability on your security. What people are doing malicious on the site. What things are sort of like malicious intent and benign or actually, yes, there's a damage, there's a breach. You want to discover those and not discover 3 months later when somebody, you know, calls in support with something funky and saying, oh, you know, something has gone wrong, and you do your forensics and realize it's 3 months you've been open. Your data's been leaking that long. So you need to have something defensive no matter what. And the way I view WAF and RASP is generally they're basically layers. The WAF provides you that outer layer as traffic comes in. It could be bypassed, but you know it does. Like I say, it does serve a purpose. It can do a lot, but you just have to know you can't treat it as the be all and end all. It can be bypassed, and RASP gives you the defense in depth. So anything that does bypass the WAF, you get another chance to catch it, and in particular, you can catch things very much more subtle things that the WAF can't do, because WAFs will always the best you can do is infer what the data coming in will do, but you can't actually know what it does. Whereas if your insertion point is on the RASP, you can actually observe what the actual action is. And so if you are calling out to a shell, or you're calling a database you don't usually normally access, or you have SSRF, you know, you're not going to tell that in a WAF necessarily, but in a RASP you can determine with extremely high accuracy that something is wrong, and because you're inside the application, you can block that in code logic rather than, you know, on the network, and so you can be very surgical in your blocking.
Yeah, that's great. And I guess, you know, and I guess I didn't mention this in the series either. The first line of defense, obviously, is the app developers, right? They have to write secure code, and you know, and all the testing tools really are to help them fix up their stuff. But yeah, it's inevitably going to happen that they're going to miss something. They're going to create a security issue, just along with every other bug that they end up creating, right? And that's just part of it. So having the security in layers. I was using the term the toolkit, right? You want to have all of your tools, but yeah, you're building out your layers, you're using all the tools in the appropriate places. So that's, man, you summarized it really nicely. So any other thoughts, anything else that I completely missed out on?
Nothing comes to mind, but just to follow on to your point, yeah, I think that I think, you know, upfront design and thoughtfulness in designing security from the beginning, I think is key. It's just like anything else. If you're building a you want to build a castle, it's a dumb, but if you build a castle, you need to, you know, think about how you want to fortify everything. And then once it's built, you need to actually, you know, have the guards on the right place, and you have people in the watchtower, and you have to think about things in the development process. And then once things are deployed, you need to think about how do you protect it at that point. And then everything is very iterative in most modern applications. And so on the good side is that you can potentially react very quickly to issues, but the other thing is that you can also degrade very quickly if you don't have the right controls either. So you it's a sort of a double-edged sword with very fast iteration.
Yeah, that's a great point. Well, thank you so much for taking some time to chat with me and to add to the series and just trying to kind of wrap things up. So thank you for coming and helping me cover the defensive products. Boris Chen, thank you.
Anytime. Thank you very much.